What makes us a fairy couple? Because we're a couple of fairies, that's why.
I heard about a group called the Radical Faeries. I was curious right away because I thought, well, that's what I am. What I would call a fairy was a gay man who maybe had long hair, wore Birkenstocks, liked gardening, maybe a little vegetarian. Although I quickly found out that there were all kinds of fairies and that we're very diverse. I was probably about 4, 5, or 6. There were names I'd get called: sissy for playing with dolls, queer, faggot when I was in grade school, but I also got called fairy. And all the other names were real put-downs, and I knew that even if I didn't know what they meant. But I knew what fairies were because I'd seen Walt Disney cartoons and I knew of Faerie Tales, and I liked that. And so I think I knew all through my childhood that I was a fairy, and it wasn't until I heard the name Radical Faerie that something clicked. It's like, oh, yeah, that's what I am.
1979, we called a great many people together who had had a variety of feelings, of dreams, of feelings of that fairies were something other than just civil rights or getting heteros to change their minds about laws and things, that we felt that we were rather different people, but we wanted to find out who we were. So we called on people to come together and, as I said, tear off the ugly green frog skin of conformity and find the beautiful fairy prince underneath and find out who you were.
We all became precious to one another. We all we undertook a ritual at that time in which we formed a double circle, and at the center was a little raised platform, and one fairy after another would volunteer, come forth and stand on the platform and just simply talk from his heart to the rest of us. And by that means we learned that many things we thought we had gone through all by ourselves were the common experience of every one of us.
My mother had kicked me out of my house for being gay. I arrived for Gay Day in San Francisco and marched with the fairies. They said, oh, there's a gathering going on at Wolf Creek. And it's like, oh, a gathering, okay, you know. And after this whole 2 months of like searching for home, that was the whole theme of the summer, searching for home, looking for like, where do I really belong? I get up to Wolf Creek, there's this big banner that's there that says, welcome home. I was just getting in touch with, you know, the goddess in my life, and she was just like pouring down love all over us. It's like 100, 200 men just got together, and that's where I met like so many people that I know. our sanctuary exists because we will it to exist. It is a place to gather and a place to really call home. You give this place power. I mean, it is what it is. It's 80 acres of land and grass and trees and water, and you know, there's 80 acres that exist all over the place. You know, you can find 80 acres of land anywhere with buildings or whatever. But this is like a very special place where we call it the sanctuary. You know, we create the sanctuary. That's why it is what it is, because you give it a name and you put that whole creation into motion. And then you honor that. You honor the land. And then you have these faeries that come together and create power around that land.
First, I didn't really sense a conflict between my job here at the university and my being a fairy. The two worlds seemed so distant that I couldn't imagine they ever could cross. But gradually, I came to see that the life of a fairy was such a vibrant, exciting, and important part of me that it became necessary to at least attempt to integrate the two. So I started by just telling close confidants, fellow faculty members, and students who I could trust, that along with being gay, I was also a fairy. And they all took it very well, so well in fact that I decided, well, it was time to tell the entire school. So on Diversity Day a year and a half ago, I decided to come out to the school as a fairy, and it met with instant success. Students came rushing up to me afterwards. In fact, one student came onto the stage afterwards while the applause were still occurring and gave me a huge hug. And so this was the time that I told them that I was a fairy and I told them that I was sunlight.
Being in the path of liberation, I thought that one thing that was still putting me under authority of others was to carry a name that had been put on me when I was born. I wish I had the little drawing handy. The daughter of Larry Bonham, the man who taught me quilting. It was Easter time and she wanted to draw. She was drawing. And I gave her paper, and pencils, and she wrote to Oskrr, Happy Easter or something like that. And she spelled the name O-S-K-R-R. She just did it, not thinking whether it was the right spelling or the wrong spelling or sounded right or not. She just did it in love for me and gave me that name.
How long have you wanted to do this for?
Oh, I would say about 6 months.
Oh, since when? Before gathering?
Let's see. Yeah, maybe around the fairy gathering. Oh my God, it seems so easy. Is it, there are like big bald spots, aren't there?
No. Not any bald spots at all. Just thinning.
Oh, just thinning. I much prefer that euphemism. My mother has an easier time talking about me being gay than she does about me being a fairy. She can talk about one, but she won't talk about the other. My father, to his credit, has a much easier time talking about me as a fairy.
In fact, he's made a joke about my fairy name since his company is the one that makes sunlight detergent. And he's told me, well, at least you were able to select a Lever Brothers product. And then he also said, you could have called yourself Caressor Dove.
When a baby's born, it's a boy or a girl. It's the first question people ask, you know, boy or girl. From that day on, the socializing of the child happens, from the pink or blue to what activities are acceptable, what careers they can go into. A lot of surviving difficult teenage years and coming out in my 20s was realizing that I'm okay the way I am. One of the powerful aspects of doing drag is that it jolts people out of the mindset of this is how people are supposed to be. We as Radical Faeries have a lot to offer our society by jolting them in just that way.
It's rather interesting to consider how beautiful costuming, colors and forms and so on, have been reserved to women in our culture for such a long time, except for the 60s when young men took it up too for a while. How much pleasure it brings fairies in playing around with wearing women's garments, women's dresses and things like that. Sometimes they're quite consumed with admiration at the intelligence and skill and aesthetic quality that goes into clothing.
Lately I've been using my brown robe to go to Grants Pass, and I was delaying to do that until Drew said, let's go with it, put it on. And then he encouraged me to do it, and I went with him shopping at Fred Meyer's. And the three of us entered together holding hands through the automatic doors. And when we were in the shopping area, we came together and kissed each other and hugged. And then we went to do our shopping.
The fairies represented the recognition of gay people that their capacity to enjoy one another far exceeded the area of the sexual, included it, of course, naturally at the center of things, but far exceeded that domain. Now, however, it has happened in the last few years that certain of the fairies, like Joseph Kramer, for instance, have taken up sex again and said, well, why can't we extend the kinds of wonderful relationships we have with one another in all other respects that we explored as fairies into the area of sex too?
Because I think I've been taught for so long that sex was filth. I'm going the other way around. Sex is sacred. Sex is divine. It is that emotional charge connection that it brings now the value when I create altars.
Our beautiful, lovely sexuality is the gateway to spirit. Under all of organized religions of the past, Judaism, Islam, Christianity, and so on, there has been a separation of carnality, shall we say, or flesh, or earth, or sex, and spirituality. As far as I'm concerned, they are all the same thing, and what we need to do as fairies is to tie it all back together again.
We have a love of the earth. Part of healing ourselves personally and our entire culture is very connected with healing the earth. And so often fairy gatherings happen in wild places, partly for privacy, but also just to be closer to nature. Throughout the year in different places of the globe, we have these gatherings, fairy gatherings. And there's not much structure to them usually. You just get a group of people together, people who have knowledge or gifts they want to share. The one thing that most fairy gatherings have, though, is that we meet in circles, and nobody is really in charge. There might be people who've taken on different roles, like kitchen queens will keep the food trip together, and other people will facilitate in different ways, but nobody's in charge.
live in Berlin.
It's different being a fairy in the city. It's sometimes real difficult because you want to share that gathering energy like all the time. It's like you open your heart while you're there. You go back to the city, you go back to your job, and you just want to share it with everyone, and you realize that you're just in this totally magical place that not everyone gets to go to.
People can try and make changes in their lives, and they can struggle for years and years of therapy and support groups without a lot of progress sometimes. And that same person can have a conversion experience where everything changes in their life almost instantaneously. And I think that fairy gatherings have that ability, that the group energy and bringing us all together, somehow something gets freed up.